Hi guys. Today I want to discuss the elongated skulls found in northeast China. These skulls were intentionally stretched to elongated shapes. Carbon dating proves that the oldest skull is 12,000 years old, which means it's the earliest discovery of intentional cranial modification on the Eurasian continent. This site is called Houtaomuga. Even though it sounds like a very peculiar practice, artificial cranial deformation was surprisingly common in ancient times. Archaeologists have found these types of human skulls all over the world in every inhabited continent. Why did different ancient cultures all choose to do this specific hide-binding practice? Where did they get the idea? What was their motivation? Could this strange practice come from the same source? If so, where did it originate? Let's first take a look at the Houtaomuga site. It's located on the southwestern edge of the Amur River Basin. This site is a treasure trove, containing layers of Neolithic burials and artifacts dated from 12,000 to 5,000 years ago. During excavation, archaeologists found remains of 25 individuals. After putting these skulls in a CAT scanner, the researchers confirmed that 11 has indisputable signs of skull shaping, such as flattening and elongating the forehead. These 11 elongated skulls belong to both males and females, ranging from toddlers to adults. The oldest skull was an adult male who lived about 12,000 years ago, and the latest one dates to 5,000 years ago. This means the head-bending tradition lasted for an astonishing 7,000 years. DNA samples have been collected and analyzed. The 12,000-year-old male with the elongated head is numbered M45. His maternal DNA is D4H1. D4H1 is found in North Asians, American Indians, and Central Asians. A 2020 paper points out that the Houtaomuga people, as Paleo-Siberians, might have attributed to the first American lineage in Asia and America. Houtaomuga's elongated skulls are not unique in Amur River Basin. Another elongated skull was put out from the bottom of Songhua River, the longest tributary of the Amur. This skull was carbon dated around 11,000 years old and shows obvious signs of artificial deformation. This head shape can only be changed on a baby when the skull is soft and malleable. This means these ancient people were sophisticated enough to artificially modify the head shapes of newborns. Even though some elongated skulls seem pretty extreme, studies have proven such a practice would not have caused neurological impairment. At Houtaomuga, this carefully performed head-binding custom was just used on certain people. Archaeologists discovered that individuals with elongated skulls were buried with more funeral offerings, like shell decorations. Young children were treated with funeral offerings, which might suggest a high socioeconomic class. This leads to the theory that the head reshaping was a ritual associated with privileged social status and wealth. Historians believe that artificial cranial deformation existed long before recorded history. It was often identified with the ruling or elite classes. Many cultures have intentionally deformed the skulls of babies in order to achieve an elongated shape. Multiple steppe cultures practiced cranial deformation, such as the Huns and the Alans, over 1,500 years ago. Researchers think head binding was also common during the eras of Akhenaten and Tutankhamun in Egypt. Examples of cranial deformation have been uncovered in the Middle East, Europe, Central Asia, Australia, and the Americas from ancient times, as well as Oceanic and African tribes in modern times. This means the head-binding tradition lasted for at least 12,000 years. The scope of this practice is incredible. This could be the longest-running tradition in modern human history. The earliest written language is Sumerian's cuneiform, which emerged over 5,000 years ago. This means people practiced the head-binding custom for at least 7,000 years without the help of written records. It's possible that this practice had an even longer history. Maybe older elongated skulls will be found in the future. So only the elite class performed this kind of cranial modification to visually set themselves apart from the rest of their people. Why did all these different communities have similar traditions of binding babies' heads to a distinctive cone shape or elongated shape? Did it come up with the idea independently, or did this custom originate from the same region? In order to study this, I think it will be helpful to review some of the oldest elongated skulls to see if they have any connection. Besides Houtaomuga, there are a few regions which also had very early head-binding histories, Middle East, Australia, and South America. Let's check them out. Middle East. Archaeologists have known that people throughout Mesopotamia had a tradition to change their children's heads to elongated shapes. Scholars claimed artificial cranial deformation was common in the Near East during the Neolithic and Chalcolithic times, with examples dating back 11,000 years. Elongated skulls have been found at sites all over Iraq, southwestern Iran, Jordan, Lebanon, Palestine, eastern Turkey, the valleys of the Zagros Mountains, and the western shores of the Persian Gulf, dated from 7500 BC to about 4000 BC. This was a widespread phenomenon in the ancient Middle East and could be proof of community interactions in prehistory times. Australia. Some of the earliest elongated skulls have been found in Australia, at Cow Swamp, Nakri, and Kubul Creek. Some date to 11 to 12,000 years ago. The scientists have confirmed that these skulls have gone through artificial deformation. Analysis of mitochondrial DNA and Y chromosome variation in Aboriginal Australians and Melanesians confirmed that all Australian lineages fall within the mitochondrial branches M and N and the Y chromosome founders C and F. These are all enormous haplogroups that are found in ancient populations on every continent except Africa. A haplogroup is a group of people who share a common parental or maternal ancestor. Each haplogroup describes individual branches or closely related groups of branches on a genetic family tree of all humans. South America. The degree of deformation in some Houtaomuga individuals is extreme, and it's very close to the famous Peruvian elongated skulls. For those following Brian Foster, we are familiar with the Peruvian elongated skulls. The earliest examples of intentionally deformed skulls in South America were found in Peru and dated between 7000 and 6000 BC. Argentina and Chile also unearthed many skulls that present signs of artificial cranial deformation, with the oldest one dated 8,000 years ago from the Argentinian Pampas. Later in the Americas, the Maya, Inca, and certain tribes of North American Indians all used this custom. So about 11 to 12,000 years ago, people from Middle East, Australia, and Northeast China all performed cranial modification. 2,000 years after, people in South America also started this tradition. Could it be the ancient Americans inherited the head-binding idea from somewhere else? A few present-day populations in the Amazon appear to have additional ancestry from a mysterious group called Population Y. Population Y is a proposed ghost population who may have inhabited South America 16,000 years ago. Unlike most Native Americans, whose ancestors came from Siberia, Population Y was more closely related to Australian Aborigines and Melanesians in New Guinea. In 2019, there was a surprising discovery of the oldest DNA in North America from a Native American in Montana. Daryl Dusty Crawford is a member of the Blackfeet tribe. After getting his DNA tested, he learned that his ancestors were already in the Americas about 17,000 years ago. According to a preliminary analysis of his DNA, Crawford's ancestors are from the Pacific Islands. They journeyed to the South American coast and traveled north. This is further evidence proving ancient humans migrated across the vast Pacific Ocean and landed in South America 17,000 years ago. This is extraordinary. How did ancient people manage to do that? Let's picture what the world looked like 16 to 17,000 years ago. It was during the oldest driest period, when the global temperature was almost as low as the last glacial maximum. Many places in the northern hemisphere were covered with thick ice sheets. As a result, the sea level was much lower, probably about 110 to 120 meters lower than today, close to the last glacial maximum. At that time, New Guinea was connected with Australia. All of the Pacific islands were much larger, and some now submerged islands were above sea level. On this Pacific Ocean floor map, we can see a group of islands form a dotted line leading a path from Australia to South America. To be more specific, Peru. When the sea level was about 120 meters lower 17,000 years ago, it would be more conducive for such an oceanic journey to happen. Ancient people could have used these islands as transferring and recharging stops. Between 12,900 to 11,700 years ago is another global cooling event, the Younger Dryas, which caused lowered sea level. Hence, it's possible that another wave of people migrated to South America during that period of time. Considering a string of Pacific islands leading to Peru, ancient Australians and some modern Pacific Islanders had and have the tradition of hide binding. It's not a leap of faith to propose that ancient Oceania voyagers brought their hide binding tradition to South America and later Meso and North America. Remember the 12,000-year-old man at Houtaomuga? His maternal DNA is found in Northeast Eurasians and American Indians. It's a known fact that ancient North Eurasians migrated from Beringia to North America over 10,000 years ago. Therefore, it's possible that ancient Eurasians, such as Houtaomuga people, migrated to North America along with the head-binding tradition. Then what about the three regions with the oldest cranial deformation skulls? Northeast China, Middle East, and Australia are all very far apart. The people living in these places come up with the head-binding ideas independently with no shared histories. Did each populace decide on their own that tall, elongated head shapes are indicators of a high social class? Thus, each started to wrap babies' heads to the same specific cone shape. What are the odds of such a phenomenon springing up like this all over the planet with no connection or common stimulus? I think highly unlikely. Unless they were all inspired by some similar encounters, perhaps from an extraterrestrial source. However, here I'm only going to discuss earthly reasoning. I think the elongated skull tradition could be comparable to modern human development theory, where instead of evolving in different pockets around the globe simultaneously and independently, modern human ancestors had migrated out of Africa and then populated the world. What I'm considering is that a group of ancient people in one area came up with the idea of hide binding and then brought the custom with them when they migrated to other parts of the world. This widely spread cranial deformation practice could very well originated from one region. If this is the case, then where did this all begin? Probably among the three places that have the oldest man-made elongated skulls, Middle East, Northeast China, and Australia. Also, the place of origin must have been an important hub in ancient times, since people migrated from there to the other two places as early as 12,000 years ago. For that reason, the Middle East is the only viable answer. It was the crucial region where humans converged east and west, north and south, since the dawn of human society. Early human migration path studies have proven that the Middle East indeed acted as a hub or artery, somewhat like a major subway station that contained and diverted people. When anatomically modern humans migrated out of Africa, the Middle East was their first stop. Almost all humans went through the Middle East to get to other places on the planet. There is clear evidence that people migrated from the Middle East to Australia, Siberia, and Northeast China tens of thousands of years ago. On the other hand, There is basically no data that signifies ancient people from Northeast China or Australia reverse migrated to the Middle East during that period of time. For that reason, I think it's very possible that the hat wrapping tradition originated in the Middle East. Now, here's a real intriguing question. Why was an elongated skull the representation of high social class, intelligence, and wealth? Why not emphasize a different shape? What inspired a particular look? The closest extinct relatives of modern humans, the Neanderthals, also had elongated skulls. Though their skull elongated from front to back, which are longer instead of taller, most primates have elongated skulls. We can tell that the head binding was not meant to mimic the Neanderthals. Was it because people desired to make their babies look taller? Well, a person's height could be important, but it's not really associated with intelligence or social class in antiquity. It's not like a tall person would automatically be recognized as belonging to an elite class. World elites would have constantly changing and being replaced by taller individuals. I don't think this is something that a privileged class wanted to do. Was the head binding custom due to people emulating a group of elites who naturally had elongated head shapes? That is a more reasonable answer. Then who were these people? Have archaeologists found any natural elongated skulls? In the Middle East region, some mind-boggling human-shaped artifacts showing long pointed heads. Here are the Neolithic clay figures excavated from Israel, Yarmulke culture, dated to over 8,000 years ago. This is a mother goddess figure from Tel Asavan in Iraq from the same era. The most shocking ones are from Mesopotamia, Upaid period, 6500 to 3800 BC. These female figures have lizard faces, long pointed heads, and slender bodies. Some show suckling babies with similar elongated heads. The Upaid male clay figure also had a tall and long head. The Upaid period is before the Sumerian city-states. Sumerians have rounded heads and didn't do head binding, which was clearly reflected in their art. Were the Upaid and Yarmulke human figures with long pointed heads related to the head binding tradition? Were these figures made to represent these ancient people or the gods they worshipped? Did our gods have elongated skulls? I don't know, but I'm intrigued by the possibility. Artificial cranial deformation is deeply rooted in human history. If we can understand this practice better, we might uncover crucial information about who we are and where we come from. Our story is our past, and our past is still being discovered. If you have any insights, please leave me a comment. If you like my video, please give a thumbs up and subscribe. Don't forget to hit the bell button so you'll be notified when I upload new videos. I have a wide range of topics that I want to share with you. This is Curious Being. I'm Tina. Thanks for watching and see you next time.